What you just saw there was one of the most potent scenes from the 2006 indie gem, Half Nelson. The film is one of the great modern depictions of self-destruction, a theme touched on sparingly in the past that is now beginning to realize its full potential. A genre defined early on by gangster flicks and stories of the anti-hero, Half Nelson took a new approach to the idea of self-destruction and helped to assert a revitalization of the genre into the 2000s and 2010s. But before we dive into how Half Nelson got the job done, it's important that we outline the makings of the self-destruction genre and how it got to where it is today. Film has allowed us to isolate aspects of the human condition and transform them into captivating visual narrative pieces. For over a century, filmmakers have gone to great depths capturing the essentials of the human existence on camera. Over the years, certain themes of the human condition have been explored much more than others. Themes such as love, belonging, redemption, vengeance, self-realization, and many others like them have been explored in every genre, in every era of film, time and time again. One element of the human condition that I believe is intensely interesting in film is that of self-destruction and the theme of the doomed protagonist. This cinematic theme of self-destruction has been made popular ever since the silent era with the 1917 Charlie Chaplin film, The Cure. With a 31-minute runtime, The Cure follows Charlie's lonesome inebriate as he drunkenly meanders into a health spa and causes quite the commotion. Throughout the film, we are given spurts of hope that maybe this ragged drunk may have a chance to redeem himself or find his cure, but in the end, he finds himself literally falling gleefully into a pool of alcohol. Fast forward 50 years, and the genre went on to be defined by classics such as Citizen Kane, Scarface, The Godfather, Raging Bull, A Face in the Crowd, and most notably, Taxi Driver.
I'm trying you.
Mostly featuring detestable men and typically anti-heroes, films about self-destruction were pigeonholed into just that. At the dawn of the millennium, the genre began to see a change, one which reflected the lives of the more average person, not those of gangster kingpins, egomaniacal billionaires, alcoholic boxing champions, or morally bankrupt murderers. Films like Leaving Las Vegas, American Beauty, Fight Club, and more began to set the stage for the modern film about self-destruction. Let us take a look at three modern-day films and see what techniques were employed to make them stand out in the genre today. To start this off, let's circle back to where we began, with Half Nelson directed by Ryan Fleck. The film takes us along a journey following a middle school history teacher as he struggles with depression and drug addiction. The film is known for its effective use of shaky camera movement and riveting acting from Ryan Gosling and Sharika Epps. Of all the films mentioned so far, this might be the only one to use a handheld camera throughout its entirety. The shakiness of the camera helps to accentuate the fragility and uncertainty of the main characters. Half Nelson takes place over the course of a few weeks as we see how the main character of Mr. Dunn tries to cope with himself and his failures. He has lost the love of his life due to his drug usage, became estranged from his family by his own doing, and begins to accept the fact that maybe his life is past salvation. It's only once he meets a young student that he realizes that before he self-destructs, he may be able to do some good in the world. This right here is precisely what makes Half Nelson stand out. While most films of the genre of self-destruction follow one character very intently, this film lets us into the life of the young student as well, and allows us to see how Mr. Dunn's actions affect those around him. Dunn seems to be the helpless protagonist throughout Half Nelson, but the viewer can tell he wants to better himself, adding a layer of empathy to his character that was rarely seen in films about self-destruction in the past. This film also features a very sparing use of close-ups that are only used when Mr. Dunn is at his most defeated, most vulnerable. The use of extreme close-ups, shaky cam, and added storyline of the young student combined are what allow for Half Nelson to be the highly personal and unique film about self-destruction that it is. Up next, we look at what might contain the polar opposite to Half Nelson's Mr. Dunn, with Jordan Belfort in The Wolf of Wall Street. It's more than just their salary that sets these two apart. Jordan may start the film off as a relatable character, but he quickly becomes a power-hungry and greedy anti-hero. Directed by Martin Scorsese, the man behind self-destruction classics such as Raging Bull and Taxi Driver, Scorsese breathed new life into the genre with The Wolf of Wall Street instead of just rehashing his old ways. The film focuses on the spectacle, allowing the viewer to indulge in the obscene excess of Jordan Belfort.
I take Quaaludes 10 to 15 times a day for my back pain, Adderall to stay focused, Xanax to take the edge off, pot to mellow me out, cocaine to wake me back up again, and morphine, well, because it's awesome. Morning, make it.
As the film is narrated by the main character, it becomes obvious that this self-destructing anti-hero of Belfort tells his story as if this excess of his is actually his triumph. Scorsese shows us that this is actually quite the opposite, and he does this with close-ups. While the main character thinks that the joke is on everyone but him, Scorsese subtly shows us that the joke is really on Belfort and the viewer. With these close-ups, he allows us to see the tastelessness and lack of refinement of Belfort's character. The film is self-destruction disguised as success. But while Belfort is the antagonist of his own story, he too is just as helpless as Dunn from Half Nelson. The narration and the editing tell two separate stories in The Wolf of Wall Street. The narration giving us insight into the mind of a delusional, self-destructive man.
See, money doesn't just buy you a better life, better food, better cars, better pussy. It also makes you a better person.
And what's on screen showing his reality, his downfall. Lastly, we have Annihilation, the film that is not only the newest of the three, but the one that might be the most unique of the bunch. The 2018 film gives us the impression that the genre of self-destruction will be left in good hands with the current generation of filmmakers. Two recurring themes in movies about self-destruction are the fact that the lead is almost always a man, and that the story is set within the real world. Annihilation defies both of those tropes. Starring Natalie Portman, this sci-fi thriller breaks new ground for the theme of self-destruction. In an interview with CNET, Annihilation director Alex Garland states that in science fiction you have permission for big ideas and more flexibility to explore fundamental ideas of human existence. Pulling self-destruction out of its usual place of real-world dramas and putting it into the sci-fi genre allows for an entirely new take on the theme. Within the sci-fi genre, self-destruction can take on more abstract ideas and leave more up to interpretation. For example, Annihilation uses the lens of sci-fi to show physical examples of mutation within the environment and the characters. The shimmer, the made-up area in which the movie takes place, refracts all DNA within it, slowly destroying and mutating whatever or whoever is inside of it. The main character, Lena, enters the shimmer, fully knowing her demise awaits her, accepting her self-destruction. Annihilation takes the fundamental idea of self-destruction and turns it on its head, demonstrating how someone entirely new can be created through their own self-destruction.